The disciples came to Jesus and said, "Who is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven?" So he called a little child to him and set the child in front of them. Then he said, "I tell you solemnly, unless you change and become like little children, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven. And so, the one who makes himself as little as this little child is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven. Anyone who welcomes a little child like this in my name welcomes me. See that you never despise any of these little ones, for I tell you that their angels in heaven are continually in the presence of my Father in heaven." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Is it credible to believe in angels? And if so, can we believe that we all have a guardian angel? Well, firstly, we can look to the credibility of Scripture, and we find them attested to in our holy writings. And on Tuesday, we celebrated three archangels, Michael, Raphael, and Gabriel, whose names have been revealed to us. Next, we can look to the credibility of our Lord Jesus Christ, who in today's Gospel speaks of the reality of angels. Next, we can look to the wonder of our own being. Why should we even exist? And just because we cannot see angels, maybe this simply speaks to our own limitations, rather than the evidence of angels not existing. Next, we can think of other matters of our faith that we hold as true, but are equally as challenging to our reason. The resurrection, for one, makes belief in angels a walk in the park. That you think and believe that today the bread and wine will turn into the body, blood, soul, and divinity of Jesus Christ makes belief in angels a walk in the park. We confess our belief in the Holy Spirit, that there appears no tangible way of proving his existence, and yet the Church throughout her history has attested to the effects and fruits of the Spirit. And many of us would be able to say we have experienced the Holy Spirit in our life. So as it does seem very credible to believe in angels, what do guardian angels do? They watch over us and protect us. But what are they protecting us from? They are less concerned with our physical safety. That's not to say that they won't look out for our physical safety, but they are more concerned with our spiritual welfare. Remember when we anoint the sick, for example, the healing is primarily associated with the soul rather than the body. And so the same is true of the angel's protection. As Saint Jerome says, "How great the dignity of the soul, since each one has from his birth an angel commissioned to guard it." We can make, though, two mistakes, I think, when it comes to angels. One, if you've ever sat through a delightful school nativity, we see the children dressed up as angels, but look rather more like fairies. They are, however, fearsome creatures. When they appear, their greeting in Scripture is invariably, Do not be afraid. Secondly, the other mistake we can make is we think we are destined to be angels. When someone dies, we often hear that heaven has gained another angel. But we know that God does not give the inheritance of heaven to an angel, but to a son. In holy baptism, we have all become adopted sons of God in the Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. We are destined to be higher than any angel. They remain dedicated servants of God and his people, but we are destined to be sons of God. So thank God we have a guardian angel to keep us safe until we collect our inheritance. broke the bread and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took this precious chalice in his holy and venerable hands, and once more giving you thanks, he said the blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." Mystery of faith. Save us, Savior of the world, for by your cross and resurrection you have set us free. Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the Blessed Passion, the resurrection from the dead, and the glorious ascension into heaven of Christ your Son, our Lord, we, your servants and your holy people, offer to your glorious majesty, from the gifts that you have given us, this pure victim, this holy victim, this spotless victim, the holy bread of eternal life, and the chalice of everlasting salvation. Be pleased to look upon these offerings with a serene and kind countenance, and to accept them as once you were pleased to accept the gifts of your servant, Abel the Just, the sacrifice of Abraham, our father in faith, and the offering of your high priest Melchizedek, a holy sacrifice, a spotless victim. In humble prayer, we ask the Almighty God, command that these gifts be borne by the hands of your holy angel to your altar on high, in the sight of your divine majesty, so that all of us who through this participation at the altar receive the most holy body and blood of your Son may be filled with every grace and heavenly blessing. Remember also, Lord, your servants who have gone before us with the sign of faith, and rest in the sleep of peace. Grant them, O Lord, we pray, all who sleep in Christ, the place of refreshment, light, and peace. To us also, your servants, who those sinners, home in your abundant mercies, graciously grant some share and fellowship with your holy apostles and martyrs, with John the Baptist, Stephen, Matthias, Barnabas, Ignatius Alexander, Marcel Linus, Peter, Felicity, Perpetua, Agatha, Lucy, Agnes, Cecilia, Anastasia, and all your saints. Admit us, we beseech you, into their company, not weighing our merits, but granting us your pardon, through Christ our Lord, for whom you continue to make all these good things, O Lord. You sanctify them, fill them with life, bless them, and bestow them upon us. Through him, and with him, and in him, O God, almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honour is yours, forever and ever. Amen. At the Saviour's command and formed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Saviour, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory of
all. Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit."
So just as a reminder, as we come to the Holy Communion, please make a spiritual communion an act of thanksgiving. When I receive, Holy Communion will be distributed at the end of Mass. The stewards will direct you. Please don't move past the red line unless you know it's clear. And on the way out, please, you can give your weekly offertory if you haven't already done that. spiritual